Welcome to Draw One Last Breath podcast. My name's Matt.
And I'm Paul.
Welcome to episode 82. We've been to the cinema and we're going to review Freaky. In our Something to Scream About, we're going to be talking about 88 to 89 in The Search of Darkness Part 2. And not only that, we'll be doing our movie from The Vault, which I picked, Humanoids from the Deep.
And what a fucking pick. Can't wait to talk about that later.
Wow, yeah. Here we go. How you doing, mate? You all right? You sound a bit groggy.
I'm doing all right. I'm going for my own horror show at the moment. I had my second jab, and it's hit me, unfortunately. So I'm sweating a little bit and a bit croaky, but I'll be fine.
Well, make a change for me to do all the talking, won't it?
Yep.
So what have you been watching? Anything recently?
Mate, you're going to be fucking pleased with me.
Why am I pleased with you? Go on, tell me.
I have been all over the fucking streaming sites. Okay, I'm going to start with Amazon Prime.
Yep.
And I watched Assault on Precinct 13.
Assault on Precinct 13?
Assault on Precinct 13.
Yep. Which one?
John Carpenter one.
Original one, good.
From what, like 1976?
Yep.
It's fucking old, man. Just a year after Jaws.
Mm.
A lot of similarities between there, I thought.
It's a great movie.
It is fucking awesome. It is incredible. The acting, just everything about it. Again, the music is just incredible. I really, really enjoyed that. Moving on to, well, I'll talk about this in a minute. So, Shudder, next. A film called Vicious Fun that I said I was going to watch.
Okay.
It was about a horror magazine reviewer gets really pissed and stumbles onto a serial killer support group.
Oh, I think you've told me about this on the previous episode, right?
Really quirky, really funny, and has some like great like longness to it, as in like I want to see what's next sort of thing.
Okay.
It's really cool and quirky, I thought. Fun. Okay. Literally fun. Vicious fun. Gore.
Vicious fun.
Loads of gore, loads of quips. It's got a matey boy from do you ever see American Office?
I know the characters.
Well, he's the one. He's Champ. He's from Anchorman. He plays Champ.
Oh yeah, I know.
He's in it as well. So there's there's a known. So
yeah.
Really good actually. And then Netflix gave us the first two installments of their trilogy of Fear Street.
Mm.
Now this is broken. Social media over the last couple of weeks.
It's broken freaking Netflix as well, mate, when I tried to watch the second one because it was all fuzzy.
Yeah, I heard a lot about that, actually. I mean, I managed to watch both. Mm. I've watched 94 and 78, so...
I've watched one and a half.
But the thing I wanted to talk about was the pop-up.
Yes, yeah, there's three, isn't there?
One in Brighton, I think one in Shoreditch, and the other another one in London. I can't remember where it is in London.
Mm.
These things look worth going to if you are around those areas and worth checking out. They're sort of like mini secret cinemas, I think.
Yeah, it's like a bit like the one in America is a really famous one, isn't it? I can't remember what it's called. Is it called? I can't remember. But there's one in America that's the same. It's like you can't really touch anything, but they have all the VHS cassettes on the wall. So it's set out like an old school video shop, right?
Yeah, I would love to go. I don't think I'm going to get to, but I'd love to go. I've seen loads of pictures and stuff. That looks cool. But let's talk the movie, man. What did you think about the first two? Or the first one? Okay.
Well, I watched half of the second, but let's talk about the first one. Yeah, I thoroughly enjoyed it. Really, really loved it. Like, literally, obviously, it's R.L. Stine, obviously, that did all the Goosebump books. I was really, really kind of like, is it going to be a bit kiddified, teenagery? But mate, it did not like fail to please me with everything. Storyline was great. The effects really, really cool. It went places that I didn't think it'd go. Characters are really cool. Did a little heel turn and stuff. Obviously loads of nods, and it's obvious nods to all the films from the 90s, like Scream and everything like that, and slashers and stuff, but it's not doing it. It's paying that homage to it, isn't it? It's not really ripping it.
Yeah, and putting a unique stamp on it as
well. Yeah, totally.
I mean, that opening sequence with Scoops Ahoy Robin.
Yeah.
Was absolutely fantastic, because I thought she was going to be a main character, and they pulled the rug out of your eye like Drew Barrymore. It's fucking fantastic.
It's an obvious nod, wasn't it? Yeah. Even the slow-mo bit when, spoilers, he runs up behind her and they slow it down, exactly like the Drew Barrymore kill at the start.
Blood was good, camera was good, production was good, music was fantastic.
But really that, the music did crack me up, because it was literally song. Like, I turned to my missus, I was like, are they taking the... I think they're being really satire, like, joking around, because it was literally one song to the next, which I ain't worried about, like, because I fucking loved every single song, because obviously it's from when we were of that age when we listened to that sort of music.
Yeah, a bit of Garbage, mate, bit of Pixies and stuff. That's nice references. It was very true to the era. I thought it was lovely. And then, like, the characters really sort of... You cared for them.
Yeah.
I gave a
likeable,
shit.
Likeable characters.
Really, really, really likeable characters. And spoilers. No, maybe not spoilers, but just, you know, we lost friends in this movie. Really, really dramatically. And really, really, some of the best use of special effects I've seen in a long time. Practical special effects and fucking really, really interesting ways to go, and gore was fantastic. I my jaw dropped.
Yeah, it wasn't afraid to go there, which I didn't think it was going to. It totally lived up to expectation, because it's just like, I didn't think it was going to do certain things. I was like, oh, it's going to be like the same kind of laid out kind of storyline, but it didn't. It done different new things, which was really, really cool.
Yeah, and on to the second, mate, which you haven't seen. I won't talk about it too much. I'll wait until you've seen it, but it was a very, very reminiscent of that Friday the 13th slasher vibe, obviously set in a camp as it is. But I absolutely loved the antagonist.
Sex. I'm sorry.
The antagonist in it. And I love the deaths, and I love the use of the weapons that they used. It was just absolutely awesome. And she's great as well.
I've got a tiny little Max fact before you go on. That was actually shot where one of the Friday films was shot.
Jason Lives.
Yeah, you've been on Bloody Disgusting, haven't you?
It was set in the same park. Yeah. The same park. So the camps were actually two separate sort of locations, but it's a big fucking park. So it's cool. It's, you know, they
I thought that's fucking awesome. Ace.
But it's just great. It was like, is that era? It was bang on.
Yeah.
Again, and then moving on to, you know, the next installment was 1666.
Probably not the era that we both are into, but because the storyline is so good, maybe it might be something different.
We shall see. I think we're getting into Back to the Future 3 territory, but...
there's nothing wrong with Back to the Future 3.
We'll see what happens. Looking forward to it. So there you go. There's my feast of movies. What about you? You watched anything else?
No, fuck all.
Well, Fear Street, good.
Yeah, that's about it, really. It's been a busy old couple of weeks, isn't it?
Sad. Let's not talk about anything else.
No.
Definitely.
There is nothing else to talk about.
Right, moving on to let's talk about some news. You got any news, bud?
I have got a few bits of news, actually. First bit is there's a new offering going to be coming out for May 24, and it's called Lamb.
Lamb?
So, yeah, it sounds a bit weird, but it's a bit freaky. You know A24, mate. They love to.
Wow, they bought us Midsummer and Hereditary.
So. This one is going to have Noomi Rapace, you know her from Prometheus. She's in Prometheus?
Yes. Yeah.
So she's apparently going to be in it. The trailer made its way online last week with news that A24 had acquired the biblical drama that tells a story of a childless couple in Iceland who find a newborn who is half human, half sheep on Christmas Eve.
Amazing. Like Sweet Tooth, but with a horror twist, yeah?
Maybe, yeah. But apparently it's going to be pretty mental. So I'm looking forward to seeing what that has to offer.
Definitely.
Have you got anything?
Well, I got a movie from, I think it's... There's been the first reviews for a film called Titane from Julia Doc... Now, I'm sure if I got that right. But she shocks with a controversial, gory and ballsy body horror. Now, she's the one who bought us Raw.
Oh, cool. I love Raw.
Yeah. It's really good. But this one is, I mean, how can I describe it? The plot follows a series of unexplained crimes where a father is reunited with the son who has been missing for 10 years. This is the mega spoiler that I'm going to say, and hopefully this will get your first for this movie, okay? So, mega spoiler warning. This offers up a taste of the nasty in the first 10 minutes. A car crash, an up-close shot of an open cranium surgery, neon-lit car showgirls twerking and grinding in hot pants, body modification, body scarification, girl-on-girl flirtation, girl-on-girl copulation, girl-on-machine copulation, boobs, bums, blood and bath, and about five gruesome murders in the first 10 minutes.
Jesus Christ.
I mean, what?
Full-on.
We fucking need to see this movie.
Sounds like a full-on, like, David Cronenberg-esque, but with more boobs and bums.
Well, funny you should say that. Funny you should say that. It does say a cross between David Cronenberg's Crash and the horrors of Takeshi Mixkuzu. So, I mean, this looks fucking fresh and new. I'm looking forward to it.
Sounds mental.
Love it. What about you? You got anything else?
I'll be watching that one for sure. Yeah, I've got quite a funny bit of news, actually. Mattel have just, you know, Mattel that bring out, obviously, toys. They've got a new Jurassic Park action figure. And it's Samuel Jackson's character, Ray Arnold.
Yes.
So, like, everybody wants to know how he died, because obviously you don't see how he dies, do you? So this figure's got a detachable arm, because you only see his arm.
Yeah, Yes.
They only find his arm, and that's this. With this toy, you get a raptor, and you get him, and his arm comes off, and he's like got blood underneath. It's so cool. So I thought that was quite funny. So that's coming out soon. So I
always forget that he's in that movie.
Yeah, I know. He's not in it very long, though, is he? Really?
No.
Got any news? Or?
No, I got a few up and coming movies that are coming out.
Give it to me.
The next couple of weeks, we've got on the 14th of July, which is obviously today, the day we're recording the podcast, a film on Netflix called The Classic Horror Story, which is a sort of slasher set in the in southern Italy.
Mm.
So looks at the trailer, looks very interesting, very, very looking forward to that.
Okay.
Forever Purge is out on the 16th of July.
Mm-hmm.
So go see it at your peril. No, I'm sure it'd be lovely. And then the film that we reviewed last year, a year before, Escape Room, has got a sequel that we thought would get. This one's called Escape Room Tournament of Champions, and it is also out on the 16th of July.
I like the first one.
Yeah, man.
I'll have some more of that.
Well, who knows if we might be reviewing it
for a future episode.
What about you, dude? Got anything else?
Yeah, I've got a couple of bits. I'll just fire through them real quick. So there's apparently going to be a new installment of the Pet Sematary franchise in the work at Paramount. So this is going to be interesting. So I'm not sure where the story is going to be kind of at, whether it's before or something like that. But there's no word on the plot details yet. And it's a brand new story set within the world of Stephen King's Pet Sematary. So I quite liked the last one that they did. I thought it was all right. It wasn't amazing, but still prefer the original.
For those trucks.
You're not a massive fan of the original, are you? After our review.
It serves a purpose. I prefer the book. The book's amazing. I'm sorry, but that is just one of those things that annoys everyone. I'm sure you just go, the book's better than the movie. Well, yeah. In this case, it definitely is.
Also, you know, at Universal Studios, they always do their Halloween Horror Nights.
Yeah.
So, like, basically 30 nights in September and October. And the new, you know, they always have a theme, like it's either Saw or kind of like The Conjuring. This one is going to be The Haunting of Hill House. How cool would that be?
That's going to be fucking freaky, man.
Obviously, this is for our friends across the pond in America. I just wish they'd bring it over here. It'd be amazing. But apparently, like, there's loads of characters they're going to have in it, and the bent neck lady's going to be there.
Scared, people. Be scared.
Yeah, it's going to be crazy. That's going to be nuts, mate. One day we'll get to go, hopefully. One day. And the last thing I want to talk to you about is, we briefly talked about the other day, is we've both watched the trailer for Marvel's What If, right?
Yes. Wow, this has got a definite horror twist. I mean, I've got a few of the comics for this. Marvel fucking zombies by the looks of things.
Crazy.
I know, man. But they can do what the fuck they want.
I know. I mean, it's just, it looks really, really interesting. The animation looks amazing, doesn't it?
It's got that sort of 1940s sort of feel with like that modern twist. They've obviously taken some stock of some of the work from Love, Death and Monsters. I mean, it maybe Into the Spider-Verse as well. It's just the animation looks stunning. Like Captain Peggy.
They've got some of the actual real voices as well, haven't they?
I do believe they do. Mm. Michael B. Jordan, for one. I know that he's doing a voice.
Yeah.
Yeah, mate, honestly, this is going to be cool. I mean, we're going to say goodbye to Loki, I guess, this week. And What If is before the end of the summer, I want to say.
August 11th.
So there you go, very soon. So that'll fill the gap between...
I can't believe that came out so fast. It came, literally, announced it and it's like, whoa.
Boom.
And I'd like to believe they're only short as well, like 20 minutes long or something. Yeah. So... totally up our street with like the likes of Invincible. Straight, that's going to be fucking amazing. I know it. It's going to be so interesting. Like some of the things, it's like, I saw that bit where, I know we're getting off topic here, but the bit where Black Panther comes out and Yondu is with Yondu.
T'Challa's basically Star-Lord.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So weird. But I love it. Give it me, man. It sounds so cool. It sounds so interesting. So yeah, I'm looking forward to that.
Really, really looking forward to that. And then after that, we'll get Hawkeye. And on to Eternals. Anyway, this is not a Marvel-based podcast. Let's move on to some fucking... Should we talk some fucking horror? Should we talk? Get on to our main review?
Let's get freaky, mate.
Good morning.
That's me, Millie. Ordinary, boring Millie.
I love your dress.
I think I saw it at Discount Bonanza.
Okay, so I was never the most popular.
Homecoming's this weekend.
Booker is gonna be at the dance.
And boys never really noticed me.
Wow!
Honestly, if this was a horror movie, I'd be one of the first ones to get killed.
Creepy dude in the mask.
Okay, this episode's main review is Freaky, starring the amazing Vince Vaughn, Catherine Newton, Celeste O'Connor, Misha Oshevich. I mean, after this little bit, whet your appetite. After swapping bodies with a deranged serial killer, a young girl in high school discovers she has less than 24 hours before the change becomes permanent. I mean, this is Freaky Friday with a lovely little serial killer twist. So yeah. That lovely movie with Lindsay Lohan and what's her face.
There's about three movies.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And, you know, we had Happy Death Day and Happy Death Day to You recently, which is a nice groundhog sort of twisty horror. This is interesting, turning those sort of really campy comedies into a sort of horror mashup.
Yeah. I mean, it's written by Christopher Landon, which did, obviously, Happy Death Day 2, Paranormal Activity, and he's done other horror stuff. And as soon as I saw that, I knew that I was going to enjoy it. It's like, he knows his horror. And I cannot believe that you know, imagine being in that boardroom when they put that idea forward. It's like, ping, how could no one think of this before? Like, take Freaky Friday and just basically replace it with a killer and a teenage girl.
Who could play both a serial killer and a teenage girl? Oh, what about Vince Vaughn?
Yeah.
Oh, my fucking word. I loved him in this.
It was really clever because obviously when... before I get on that, the opening scene's awesome. Really, really good. Really, like, straight in with the kind of, like, classic horror in a house. It's raining, and it's just like... the opening scene was brilliant.
Randy teenagers, like, sort of discussing, drinking, doing stuff. But it had a nice little twist. It had the runaway girl, and it had all those fucking classic moments and those great movie horror tropes that we sort of love.
Mm.
It was classic. It was a classic start, but done fucking very, very well.
Yeah. So, I mean, he's obviously the killer, the butcher. he's basically obviously stalks them. And the girl's house is like full of artifacts that her dad kind of collects, right?
And yeah, he's very much like an Indiana Jones guy by looks of things, but probably not Indiana.
Yeah. And obviously Vince Vaughn finds this kind of weird kind of knife that seems to come to life when he gets it and stabs someone, which is really weird. But who gives a fuck? It's a nice little twist on, you know, the way they approach the story, because I can't remember what happens in Freaky Friday. I think it's just, isn't it like lightning or storm or something happens?
I think it was probably an artifact as well in that.
I don't think it was.
No,
I can't remember. But anyway, regardless of the point, this when the switch happens, it's so clever because like Vince Vaughn, just all the mannerisms and the little kind of things he says, just it's just so funny because you can believe him as being a teenage girl. It's really weird.
It's so weird and like
it's so funny as well.
We get Millie, who is played by the lovely Catherine Newton, as a very sort of shy introvert girl. Lost her dad a couple of years ago and still not really got over that, but she just plays it very well. She is that, it is that sort of massive heel turn. It's the one person you sort of stab, and if you swap bodies with, then she's going to act different. You know, she's going to put on a leather fucking coat and she's going to look different the next day and everyone's going to think she's hot. And it's classic fucking story from the 90s and stuff like that, but it fucking worked so well in this. And then Vince Vaughn's,
I think she could have been a bit more dweeby though.
All right, but the Vince Vaughn bit, like when he's like acting, there's some fucked up funny bits in this movie. I mean, the premise is obviously quite straightforward. She's got 24 hours to fucking, you know, to find this killer that's in her body and stab him. The, you know, the weapon's not readily available. There's lots of antics that needs to happen for them to actually be able to, her and her mates as well. And, you know, there's just so much that needs to happen for it to work again. And it's quirky, funny. And they get lots of really interesting, you know, deaths along the way.
Mm.
Some really interesting kills.
And Vince Vaughn gets to do a dick slap, which I found hilarious.
He does get to do a dick slap.
Because, I mean, like, literally, you've got to think about what a teenage girl would do in a man's body, which is funny because obviously she's now got a dick and she's never had a dick before. So it's just funny how they breached that subject and stuff like that, and how big, and obviously how big and looming Vince Vaughn's character is. It's just like, it's crazy. And then the flip side, obviously he's in her body, but she also, obviously the girl that plays Millie, is so clever at being that, just her facial expressions being really like moody and kind of silent and just like he is. So it's really weird how they kind of like, but they both do a really good job from going from dark to light and light to dark. And it's just like, it's really clever. I thought they did it really well.
Let's talk about some of the deaths in this.
Yeah, let's do it.
So the start, we get four at the start.
Is it four? Was it? Four, oh yeah, four of them. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, when one of them gets rammed up against a, I don't know, was it a coat rail or something like that? But that was quite good. That was good. Some of the surprise deaths.
Yeah, that coat. That's the one where the girl gets like stabbed to the wall. That's blatant Halloween reference. Yeah, yeah.
Definitely. There was I don't know if this is a nod to Jason X with the sort of whole like liquid nitrogen.
Yeah, what was that?
The fuck was that in a school?
Was it like, is it like a regeneration thing? Yes. Where like it makes you really cold after, your muscles really cold after active stuff?
Yeah, you get ice baths usually in most schools.
Yeah, but this must have been a major fucking like posh school.
Yeah, because it's like a cryo unit, which she got locked in and, you know, you got froze to death and you got that classic sort of death, which is quite interesting. I kind of enjoyed that.
That was quite a good little bit, but I thought exactly the same as you did.
The professor death was fucking cool. That was on the old in the old wood shop.
Yes. He was a fucking asshole. You know where he's from, don't you?
No.
Ferris Bueller's Day Off.
Oh, really?
He's the friend. I can't remember his name now.
Oh, fucking hell.
But he's his friend that he trashes his dad's car. Oh. It's him. I couldn't believe it. Yeah, he was a bastard that you knew straight away because he was just so horrible. Like, and you know, there was teachers like that when I was at school where they root you out and they just pick on you all the time, constantly. And obviously when she's now the butcher, she's like, but the scenes are pretty graphic. Like, she gets fucking punched and kicked by this teacher. Like, proper hard.
That's a funny scene, man. You know, the teacher beating up a student, effectively, obviously, which is in the body of, you know, inside is a serial killer at the end of the day. It's just funny to watch. No. You can tell he's loving it as well. He's like, he's been goading her at the real Millie, like, for most of the term, by the sounds of things. And he's just fucking her up. It's funny. And then, obviously, she gets the best of him. And we get a nice little saw scene. Nice little, you know, the wood saw, which is fucking good. Good special effects.
His actual actor's name is Alan Ruck, and he played Cameron. Cameron. Knew it was there somewhere. Yeah, but that was a very, very good scene.
Very good kill. And then it's like the antics of, oh my god, this is the most ridiculous. The thing, one of the most ridiculous things in the whole movie, which made me laugh out loud, was.
I know which bit you're going to talk about.
Oh my god. So Millie's got a crush, and her crush figures out that Millie's in this body, Vince Vaughn's body. And as they're trying to get the weapon back, aren't they, at the police station?
Yeah.
There's this hilarious, hilarious scene.
Well, they're just flirting, aren't they?
They're just flirting. And it's like watching Vince Vaughn flirt with like a teenage boy. And you'll think, okay, that's not really going to go any further.
It was just funny. Isn't it funny.
Yeah. And they had a little snog.
It was fucking.
It was so weird. It was just like,
I was quite surprised because not many people laughed at that in the cinema, but I thought it was quite funny.
I'm glad they went for it. It was just like, he didn't give a fuck. He's like, oh, you're not. I know that you're the real Millie there, and he just has a little smoochy Rooney. It's fucking. Vince Vaughn's great. Absolutely fantastic.
It was funny.
You get like the inevitable, sort of. I don't know what's the dance has been cancelled,
so it's been reorganized in some place, isn't it, like on the down low.
Yeah, and like Millie's in and she's like, you know, trying to pull the hot boy and just kill off as many people she can, really.
This is where it got quite dark, which I didn't think it was going to go here, but like literally when she kind of like comes, well, the butcher comes onto a guy because he wants to lure him away. He kind of follows her and she lures that one kind of college football guy away. And then suddenly two of his friends appear from where they were. And it's just like, and there's a real kind of strong line. I don't know if it needed to be in it, but it's pretty full on. It's like,
well, they were going to run a train on her.
If you want to put it like that,
that's what they were going to do.
It was the way they said it. It was just like, oh, as far as I can see it, there's three guys here and there's three holes. And that's the only bit of... I just think that's fucking unnecessary, man. It was fucking a bit full on. For a film of like such film with quite funny kind of satire, and it's really cool, and it has quip whips, and it was like the writing's really good, but... That's the one bit I was like, that's quite full on. I think didn't need to go there with that. But, hey ho.
Crossed the line for you. But everyone, they got theirs, didn't they?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And we get a showdown, and then we get, you know, the inevitable happens and stuff like that. You know, back to normal, or isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of a nice ending. It's a nice tie-up, actually. I kind of liked it, the way they sort of went with it. So you've got a good character arc out of it. You know, the killer's never dead, guys. That's all we say. The killer's never dead.
Maybe.
So it was. It's a really interesting, fun, quirky movie with lots of good music and stuff like that.
Great one-liners,
apart from Matt's three holes one line. But yeah, just really good fun. I loved watching this in the cinema. I know that when we saw it like come out like last year, it's been a while. It's been out there for a while. So you guys in America. And abroad have already seen this, I'm sure. and we're slow on the uptake over in the UK, but this is fucking great. It's going to be really hard to, like, really interesting for our top 10 a year, because this is fantastic.
Yeah, it was
really good fun. I really liked it. And there's much, you know, there's loads more movies coming out this year, but this is still contender for me.
Yeah, it's nice to see a bit of comedy horror as well. A bit of light relief.
Well, we had Becky last year, didn't we, with Kevin James.
Mm.
And so these mainstream actors want to come in and do these sort of these horror movies, because horror's big.
Mm.
Horror is big, and they're just making...
It pays.
It does. So really, I know, does. Becky didn't do as well as Freaky. Freaky did very well.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. It's a shame, but if you do get out and see Becky, because it's definitely worth a watch.
I'd agree. Right, Freaky. Go see it, go watch it, go have some fucking fun. Go and support horror for this one. This is fantastic. It's at the cinema now. What are you rating this then, Matt?
I'd say I would give this a probably 8 breaths out of 10, because I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, definitely agree with you on that one. It's an 8 moving to a 9. It's just fantastic. It's got some good rewatchability as well. But yeah, an 8's fair.
Now, the only reason I'd say I'd give it an 8 is because I saw Fear Street, and I think I enjoyed Fear Street more. Just.
Yeah, okay.
That's probably seeing it in the same week. Don't know if that, because Fear Street was supposed to be a theatrical release.
Really?
Yeah, but Netflix bought it up and obviously did their thing with it. But I would have liked to have seen it, so that would have been quite cool, but hey-ho.
Fear Street is probably one of the best things that's come out this year so far.
Mm.
It is ridiculously...
Well done. Well
done. And the I don't know, the marketing to go along with it is a big thing.
The marketing, the casting, the music, the way it's shot is just so clever. And also putting three weeks is clever. Very good.
Well done, Netflix. I mean, yes, good on Freaky. Love that. On our next episode, what are we watching? We've got options.
Yeah, we don't know yet.
So we don't know. We've mentioned a few that are
coming out.
We're
not going to nail one down.
Forever Purge. We're going to, you know, we might go and watch the Forever Purge. We might go and watch Escape Room and see which one we like the best and review that one. Or whichever the one's the shittest, maybe. Who knows? let's move on to our something to scream about. What do you want from me? Why don't you run from me? What are you wondering? What do you know? Why aren't you scared of me? Why do you care for me? When we all fall asleep, where do we go? Right, this episode's something to scream about. We are bringing our conversation with In Search of Darkness Part 2 to a close by discussing 1988 and 1989, looking at their movies that they're discussing in the documentary. And, you know, have we seen them? Have we reviewed them? Will we be reviewing them? Let's discuss, shall we?
Let's do it.
Right. To start, I mean, okay. 1988. Great year.
Mm-hmm.
Great year. I was 8. You were 10?
Yep.
10. This is a good age for you for horror. So, is this... Okay. First one. Beetlejuice. Tim Burton's Beetlejuice.
Mm-hmm.
Is on there. Talk to me.
Beetlejuice, absolutely amazing. Keaton just plays that role fucking so well. It's got so many cool effects in it. Tim Burton, the cast is just insane in it, you know. Winona Ryder, and so many others. But I can't even remember when I first...
Jimmy Davis, Alec Baldwin.
Yeah, but I don't think I can remember seeing this film. And I think I might have seen this one, not from the video shop. I think I might have seen this one on TV, you know.
I remember watching it on TV. I was in a video shop, but I don't think. I just remember it going around the school playground.
Mm.
And it was nice fucking model. That fucking line and was just like synonymous.
Yeah.
In our school. I remember watching it for the first time and just going, oh my fucking word.
It's one of my wife's favourite movies as well. This is.
It's a good one. It is definitely up there for a future watch as well. This is one that we will be reviewing at one Sunday.
Yeah, I mean, I forgot. It's comedy horror, isn't it? So it's definitely in the wheelhouse.
Definitely in the wheelhouse.
But I wouldn't even have thought of that, to be honest, if I didn't see this.
Mm.
I don't think.
Because it's fantastical, but it isn't the horror. There's ghosts, it's ghouls, it's the dead.
It's got the mum at Home Alone in it, and she's great. She makes it 10%. Oh,
man, I wanna go home.
It's right at the end of it.
Love it. Oh, mate, this next one. Hollywood Chainsaw Hookers.
Not seen it.
Want to see it.
I've always picked it up and looked at it, looked at the back of the cover. I do want to see it, absolutely.
The best thing
about... 88 Films one, I think it is. Yeah. Well. And the red case.
It's a nasty. It's what they can call a video nasty.
Yeah.
Got banned, was re-released with that whole Last House on the Left thing. They had a bit of a storm, and they banned quite a few in the late 80s, but they got re-released. To Spit in Your Grave, like Evil Dead and all that. But the best thing about this was like the poster.
Yeah, it is a quality poster.
They charge an arm and a leg. I like that. I mean, you know, lots of probably gratuitous nudity.
Probably.
Yeah, it's going to be one for the watch for at some point. This one, though, your mate Simon brought this to us, didn't he? Dead Heat. So we would have eventually found out about this.
Yep.
But thanks to our lovely listener, we got to review this on the podcast. And fucking what a movie.
Yeah, I mean, it was requested by him for us to watch. And I'd never heard of it until he told us. You never heard of it. But yeah, we enjoyed that thoroughly. You should go back and listen to the episode because it's a fucking great movie.
Yeah, proper buddy cop with a fucking horror twist.
Yeah, it's like Lethal Weapon with a horror twist. Just some batshit things happening in it.
Yeah, fucking fantastic. And to sort of go on that sort of cop theme, they did a Maniac Cop.
Yep.
Which we also have reviewed as well. Absolutely. Go and check that one out.
Mr. Atkins
and Mr. Campbell. So, yep. Fucking everyone, Maniac Cop, fucking great movie. One of my staples from when I was a kid. One of the VHSs that I saw on the fucking...
I owned that VHS on my shelf. I think I had 1, 2, and 3 on VHS at one point. Wish I'd kept them, but I never did. I think I even got a poster from the video store from like, it was like about 10p. They used to be all rolled up in the middle of the video store. And I used to go through them, take the elastic bands off, roll out. No, that's crap. It's another fucking shit one. But yeah, I definitely had that poster on my wall as well. It's crazy.
It's a fucking good poster, man. I really enjoyed that one. I always bang on about this because you like Poltergeist 2. But do you like Poltergeist 3 more than Poltergeist 2? Or
I like Poltergeist 3, but I prefer 2, personally.
For me, 3 is, for some reason, I think I got an affinity with 3. I remember watching it at a sleepover when I was, you know.
I watched 3 at a sleepover as well.
Yeah. It's just one of the, whatever reason, I didn't watch Poltergeist, but we watched Poltergeist 3.
Yeah. The effects are fucking brilliant in 3, though.
The use really of good. Mirrors. Ugh,
it was that it's the puddle thing where they go into the puddle. I always thought that was fascinating. Yeah. I was like, obviously back then you didn't have the making ofs or anything. And I was always wanting to know how that was done, and I wanted to bring it out on a nice collection, like all 3 of them, in a nice Blu-ray set. But hopefully one day they brought them out recently, but there's not much extras on it, and it's just a standard Blu-ray box set.
Well, it's interesting that I own the DVD Poltergeist and I own the DVD Poltergeist 3. For some reason, I don't have to.
You're a hater.
Not a hater. This is interesting. So 2 from Simon.
Yeah.
So he's obviously loving 88. Waxwork.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we wouldn't have found out about that. I mean, the way they sort of posted it was fantastic. Zach Galligan. You know, they did go through all those lovely, lovely details about the waxwork, about everything that we sort of discussed in terms of the universal horrors, the proper monsters and all that sort of stuff. It's a really interesting movie. We've only just, in the last couple of months, reviewed that one.
Yeah, it was good. It was good seeing that. And it's nice seeing other people talk about it, and because there's obviously clearly people who talk on the documentary that love these movies. And it's a great little movie.
Definitely. Go and check that bad boy out. Cellar Dweller. Now, I haven't seen this one. I've heard of it. I've seen the poster. The monsters looks fucking great.
You've seen the VHS on my...
Yes, I've picked it up many a time. Yeah. It looks fucking great.
The artwork's ace.
Oh, I want to watch it. I want to watch it for a future watch.
It's fucking crazy.
I love the name. Cellar Dweller.
Cellar Dweller.
Yeah, that's one to watch. Have you seen it?
No, I haven't. No, it's a proper creature feature one, and I picked it up on VHS because I tend to buy VHSs that I remember seeing in the video shop. So I just picked them up. I go, And I always used to pick that one up and look at it and look at the back. God knows why I never rented it. I just don't know. I think it's probably because I wanted to rent Nightmare on Elm Street 3 again for the 50th time, or Twins, or Commando, or fucking Big Trouble in Little China.
Look who's talking.
Yeah, and any of those, mate. It's like I probably just got sidetracked by, you know, because my dad used to go, my dad used to go to me like, you know, we can have one horror and one comedy, or one action, one horror, or one comedy, one action. So it'd only be two. We could only have two. And it was expensive in those days. So anyway, yeah, that's probably why. I just don't know why I didn't watch it, but now I've got it, so.
Yeah, we'll watch it on VHS at some point.
That'd be good.
I haven't seen this one either. I have heard of it, but I can't believe I haven't watched it. And I don't understand why I haven't watched it. Night of the Demons, because the name's great. Night of the Demons. It looks fantastic.
Yeah, I haven't seen this, but I do want to see it. Effects look really, really good in this one. Lots of practical effects. But it's definitely one for the rewatch, for definite.
There's a woman that like keeps popping up as well, which obviously we know are Kelly Mahoney's Barbara Crampton and stuff like that, but this person has eluded me. I haven't seen any of her movies. She's on two of these, Night of the Demons and
Lena Quigley. Yeah.
Have we talked about her in the past?
Yeah, she's
Return of the Living Dead.
Yeah.
Oh, she's the... Right, okay.
She's the punk. Yeah.
But she's been in shitloads.
Oh, yeah, she's been in absolutely loads. She's proper scream queen.
Like,
she's,
more than most.
She's even brought out a exercise video. It's insane, with, like, zombies in it and stuff like that. It's crazy. Lena Quigley is a scream queen, mate. You know her.
Yeah,
you know what she's been in.
She's been...
You just needed to know see some of the movies and you'll recognise her.
Yeah.
She looks very different to a lot of the movies she's in. But yeah, she's a proper horror royalty. But I would love to have her on the podcast.
Yeah, well, she was in two of the ones in 1988 that were mentioned on this list. I think it was Hollywood Chainsaw Hookers she was in, and Night of the Demons. So
yeah.
Fucking incredible. Incredible list. Return of the Living Dead. Wow. Okay, moving on to 1989. And the first movie we get, another one that we reviewed for the podcast.
I thought we would start getting into the ones we've done because we're coming to late 80s. So
more our wheelhouse. Bad Taste. Peter Jackson's Bad Taste.
What a movie. We gushed about this one on the episode, right? I think that was a big episode as well, if I remember rightly.
Yeah, it was.
But it needed it because it's just a fucking brilliant movie.
Yeah.
All out, just fucking funny, aliens, disgusting, gory, loads and loads of action. Like, absolutely loads of action.
Derek's Don't Run.
Yeah, Derek's Don't Run.
Oh, I love this
movie. Aren't I lucky? I got a lumpy bit.
I love this movie.
It's a great movie.
Yeah, go back and listen to our episode of Bad Taste. Yeah. That'd be great. This next one, though. Oh, man. This guy was passionate about this fucking movie, wasn't he? The director, Tetsu, The Iron Man.
Yeah, I've heard of it.
Never heard of
I've
it.
I've never seen it. I didn't know what it was about, but I've seen it online and stuff like that.
Black and white, very artsy, very, very...
Weird.
Weird. Just like...
It's like a mashup of robot, kind of like humans turning into robots gradually.
Well, this is funny, because this is around the same time as Akira coming out, right?
Akira.
So you've got that whole cyberpunk fucking thing. Done very well in anime and all this sorts of stuff. And then you got this guy coming along and trying to do a live action version very early on.
I saw is one clip and it literally had a bloke with literally a drill for a dick. And I was like, what is going on here?
Dude, this looks fucked up. I don't know if I could... I think it would do my head in.
Yeah, I don't know. Black and white art. I don't know, man. I don't know, I'll have to find out a little bit more about this.
We'd have to watch it together, because otherwise I wouldn't be in the right mood to watch this by myself, I don't reckon.
Yeah.
Looks very interesting. And then we get a few sequels. Halloween 5, The Revenge of Michael Myers. You know, good one in the franchise.
It's an interesting one. It's all right. It's a bit weird in places, but... It's
him going mental. There's shitloads of deaths in this one.
Yeah, there is quite a lot, yeah. But, yeah, it's just... I don't know. It's not my favourite, but it's not... I'm not saying it's bad, but it's definitely worth a watch.
Right in the middle there. In the middle. We get Shocker by Wes Craven. Now, I've seen the... You've got this on VHS, haven't you?
No.
Because I remember the cover. One. That guy just sat there like on an electric chair.
Yeah, that was the cover, wasn't it? Yeah.
Yeah.
With the craziest soundtrack as well.
Yeah, totally.
Super band.
Totally metal. Super band. It's fucking incredible. Chris Jericho was fucking talking about that. That was quite funny. But it's also the guy who plays Skinner from X-Files.
Right,
he's the main guy.
Directed by Wes Craven.
Yeah, and the makeup's fantastic. It just looks really unique. He gets like superpowers, I suppose, and he becomes electrified. But it's some kind of farce. It looks like some kind of precursor to Natural Born Killers, the way it's sort of set.
Yeah.
There's some really weird like shot ideals and stuff. It just looked fun.
It's, well, we're at that crest as well where we're just literally coming into the 90s. I'd say that Shocker looks more 90s than 80s with the music coming at that point of metal going into rock and grunge. It's like that, the way it's shot, it almost looked like a bit like a TV movie, but it was looked like it was just going in the direction of the 90s, like just crazy effects and...
Very MTV.
That sort of generation-y kind of thing.
This was weird. Richard Moseley. Silent Night, Deadly Night, Part 3.
I thought this was random, man. Part 3. I mean, obviously he's a legend. And I haven't seen this movie. I haven't even seen the first two either. I'm waiting for that. I think we should do it around this Christmas, maybe. But I thought it was a bit random. But it looked really fucking weird.
It looked very fucking weird. He was playing we've talked about Silent Night, Deadly Night, where it's sort of like the killer, you know, he kills Santa Claus, and he's a Santa Claus killer or something like that.
But this is totally different. Almost like, you know, when they do those sequels that are nothing, like we talked about it originally, like we talked about it with Chud and Chud 2, being completely different. So I think the only relevant this have to the other two movies is that it's set at Christmas. I don't think there's anything else to do with the storyline.
The same character.
Is he?
Yeah.
Oh, right, okay. I didn't know that. Maybe I'm all wrong.
Oh, mate. Looked fucking weird. And then we come on to the last movie that they discussed, which we've done for the podcast. And I think, for me, if I remember watching this, Henry Portrait of a Serial Killer, it was one of the most surprising, shocking horror movies that I've ever witnessed.
And that was requested from a friend of the pod, John Alicat, wasn't it?
Yeah, Alicat. Cheers for that, boy. John, that was something.
Disturbing.
That was something. That really, really got me.
That evoked something inside of you, didn't it?
Yeah, which made me think, after watching it again on the dock, I was thinking, fuck, I said I'd rewatch that at some point as well, because it was just so real. And Rooker's fucking great.
He is great, isn't
too
it?
Good. He's too good in this movie. That's the problem. It's very real.
Yeah.
And it's obviously based on a real story as well.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm. Yeah. Rooker's too good. I'm glad he's Yondu now. I can see some Mary Poppins, y'all. Yeah. Fucking hell. What a movie that is. All right, guys. That ties up. And there was a couple of quirky little bits. I think Robert England was talking about Robert England. That was quite funny, watching his little career from when he's going into his early days.
Movies.
As a character actor. TV shows, like he was on Manimal. Obviously, The Great V.
Love to get that in there.
All his other roles that he sort of played. He played, that was surprising to hear about The Phantom of the Opera with Bill Nighy. That was quite interesting. that was really cool. Just listen to Robert England go. And that was
The one bit that was quite interesting, I thought was good, is the movies that didn't get made kind of bit. It was quite cool. That was interesting.
Fly 2.
Yeah.
Not his version of Fly 2.
No, not Mick Garris's version, no. I knew about that before, though. But Fly 2 is really good. Underrated movie.
Yeah.
It is really good.
Son of Fly, basically, isn't it?
Yeah. But, I mean, his script just got completely changed, unfortunately. But
played to the teenage generation.
Possibly, yeah. Possibly. Well, the studios just got too involved.
That was fun. I really enjoyed talking about this one. I'm looking forward to the third one. We'll see what another third layer of movies they
bring. Well, they're on to the 90s next, aren't they?
Yes. Is that what the third installment is, then?
I think so. They're going on to 90s now.
All for that. Ready to talk about it. Film it. Do it. There are a whole new host of people to talk to.
I won't be back in that one.
Okay. Now, I've got a little question for our next Something to Scream About.
Interesting.
I'm going to put it to you. Okay. And if not, we'll go to the audience. But I would like to see, like, know which horror movie would you like to see from the antagonist's point of view?
Give me an example.
So, Alien from the view of the alien, rather than Ripley and her crew. What the movie is actually from the alien's point of view.
Oh, so I got to pick a movie and
you got to flip it, and you got to kind of work and discuss how that movie might go.
So, like, pitch you a movie. Pitch you a movie.
Oh, pretty much.
Okay.
So you're talking, if you go and say, you know, if you say, oh, I'd like to watch Alien from the point of view of Alien, you know, and then just say, how'd that go? It'd be like, what, a day in the life of the alien just goes around fucking, you know, looking for food more than anything. That sort of thing.
Okay.
Or like, you know.
No, that sounds good.
You did Halloween.
All right, stop saying them now, because okay. We'll eventually get to the one that I want.
Okay, all right, cool. Good one would be Joel. Anyway.
You've just ruined your pick.
We'll see. But yeah, it's a good idea. Get involved if you think of a movie you'd like to see from the antagonist's point of view. Send us your shit, and we'll read them out on the podcast. It'd be funny to listen to them.
Yeah, definitely. All right,
cool.
Good pick.
Right, it's time to move on to our movie from the vault.
Humanoids from the deep. A tidal wave of rampaging creatures surges from the dark and violent sea to conquer the earth.
Maybe intelligent enough to perceive man as a competitor.
Why the girls?
It's my theory that these creatures are driven to mate with man now, in order to further develop their incredible evolution.
It's enough to scare the hell out of me.
Soon the world will awake to a terrifying riptide of humanoids from the deep.
We think we know where these things come from, but we have no idea how many there are.
The Earth plunges into a battle for the survival of the fittest, where man is the endangered species, and woman, the ultimate prize. Anywhere you run, any place you hide, any time you stop, they will find you. Doug McClure, Anne Terkel, Vic Morrow. Humanoids from the deep.
Okay, so I picked this one. We have both wanted to see this for a very, very long time. It was actually covered on the In Search of Darkness documentary, part 2. And I got you this for your 40th birthday, one of your 40th birthday presents.
You did, thank you.
So, this movie is about humanoid sea creatures that start killing a fishing town's residents and raping their women, and it's up to the townsfolk and visiting biologists to fight back and fend them off. Yeah.
Called Humanoids from the Deep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
AKA Monster.
Great title, Humanoids from the Deep. Very sci-fi, very 50s, very 60s.
Humanoids
from the Deep, 1980. This was immense. I went on a journey with this one.
It's so super crazy that it's good.
Proper B movie.
Yep.
Proper B movie, but with real sort of character development and character arcs and proper storyline. Weird. But yeah, just a movie about sea creatures who are literally coming up, killing any of the blokes and any of the dogs that are in their way, and then literally indiscriminately raping women.
Mm.
Discuss.
Yeah, well, mate, first of all, I think this is probably one of the first movies that deals with contamination, like, as in, like, you know, cross-contamination, because obviously in this movie, they're putting something in the rivers to feed the salmon and get them bigger, and this is going into the ocean, and this is obviously the reason why these things have mutated or grown fast or whatever they are. So I think it obviously has a massive kind of political thing underlying, like a lot of the movies that came into the early 80s from coming out of the 70s, because again on the cusp just coming into the 80s. But what I loved about this movie, probably more than ever, was the creature design. I think we've got to talk about that first.
They weren't all the same, were they?
No. It was
some with long arms, or some like creepy little...
But they were creepy as fuck, those long arms. It's horrible. It like made it... I don't know why.
Like a yeti from the sea.
Oh, yeah. I just like... It was really weird. It was like the way they moved was quite good. The way that they just obviously kind of... It's Creature from the Black Lagoon-esque, but then they put... You know those really... Those ugly bastard fish that you find really deep in the ocean. They don't even come to the top. You know, the really... You've seen them?
I know what you're talking about. Yeah. I can't remember what the name of the...
That's what they've taken, obviously, the design from that and put it on this thing.
Like a lantern fish, I think.
Yeah, it's got big, massive mouth, and they've made a massive, big, massive brain. So they've got a huge brain on the back. But they're covered in, like, slime and seaweed and fucking... But I just thought the design of them... At points, you can see, oh, yeah, it's a man in a suit. But the effects were so well done that it didn't look shit. It looked quite good. Do you know what I mean?
I know exactly what you mean. I mean, this is a really seedy undertone as well to this movie. Obviously, these fucking things are... I mean, it's not graphic, but, you know, there is, like, you know, forceful removal of clothing and stuff like that, and sort of, like, the simulation.
Pretty obvious.
Yeah, it's some simulation and stuff like that. But, like, that's, I think, we wanted to kind of see this to see how far they go with it. And the actresses must have gone through fucking hell in this movie in terms of special effects and the way that they sort of had to react and all this sort of stuff. Bloody hell. But not only that, there was some a real... interesting tone around it. You know, you've got the whole racism through it as well.
It's got racism, it's got corporate business takeover, it's got contamination that we've already talked about. So it deals with some heavy issues, doesn't it?
Yeah, they're not it's that whole... I don't know if it's set in Alaska or Canada.
I don't know where the place is. Noyo is... I think it's actually in real life, it's in California.
Okay.
I don't know. It might have been like set somewhere else. I'm not sure.
But yeah, there's definitely a love hate relationship between the sort of local fishing town, mm-hmm. and the sort of I guess the natives and stuff that are off that they like. I don't know what, you know, what origin.
I think he's
it's an Indian settlement.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, and the other thing, even the other thing it takes is. Overfishing. It talks about overfishing, and this is 1980, and that's massive at the moment. We're in 2021, so in 1980 they're preaching this thing about overfishing and too much and how they're doing these salmon farmings and making a bit. So yeah, it's got loads of things. It's a really weird little underlining, but the storyline is actually really good.
Yeah, it's really layered, and like it goes through that sort of whole, you know, that whole character arc, the sort of the disputes between the town folk and the sort of random fights that keep on breaking out, which is just over the top and ridiculous.
When they're punching each other.
Fantastic. Yeah. Fantastic to watch. And they're like that hate. And then obviously you're still a human being. I'm still going to save you. I'm going to be... I don't care that you've hated me for this whole movie. I'm still going to save you from a fucking sea raping monster. Oh my God. The deaths, the dog killing are the bastards.
I didn't like that bit. Because, you know, when... obviously, we're going to talk spoilers about this movie already has. But there's a bit where... I can't remember his name. He comes to the party.
Johnny.
Johnny, yeah. Johnny Eagle, his name is.
Good name.
Bit wrong. But he comes to the party, and obviously the fisherman that he's in a bit of a barney with have killed his dog because they think he's killed their dogs. And that dog, I don't know if it was drugged or it was a real dead dog, but it looked pretty fucking real. I really hope it was just like a play dead dog because it looked really real.
That fucking just fight scene in the parking lot afterwards, though, was so fucking genius.
The best bit is when like there's a couple getting it on in the car, and the bloke goes, "What's all that noise?" and sticks his head out and gets punched.
Well, it was Peggy, wasn't it? Peggy who got the first rape was Peggy.
Oh god. I don't know. Let me ask you a question. I'm going to ask you this question out there. Did this movie need that? Did the movie need those bits of kind of like bra taken off, nakedness, and do you think it needed it? Would you think it would have made it a different film if that wasn't in it?
I think that's the horror. I think that's the reason why this movie is probably beloved today, is that they went there. They didn't need to. Of course they didn't. They could have got away with the horror, the suspense and stuff without it. But
they could have suggested it.
Yeah, they could. But because of the time, that's the sort of horror trope. And it made it sort of a lot more seedy. Which is probably, you know, I don't know if it would have changed the fact that I wouldn't have like loved it less, but it just made it more seedy and more memorable that they actually went there for no reason.
Well, suppose there is a reason for that being in there, whether they show it or not, I don't know. There's an argument for that, but obviously they're coming on the shore to impregnate, so that's what they do. Whether they it's you know
yeah, I mean, they're in that first like sort of like confrontation.
Hmm.
They're fucking, one of them's having his way with us, no holds barred, and then the other one's finishing off the boyfriend in the sea, you know, just like ripping his face off. Good makeup on that.
Yeah, really good makeup.
Really good makeup. Oh my god.
Yeah, it was good. That was by a camera. He's quite a well known FX artist, Roger George. Did things like Terminator. Night of the Creeps, Chopping More stuff. He's done a lot of work with prosthetics and stuff like that. So he was really, I mean, he's obviously integral in that part of it. So the other thing I wanted to talk about, back to creature design really quickly, you can totally see where James Wan got his ideas for Aquaman, you know, the Creatures of the Deep, that they were going to make a movie on, which I would have fucking loved.
Yeah.
But when you look at those again, they look literally exactly like Humanoids from the Deep.
Yeah.
He's obviously watched it.
Definitely had. These fucking things were like, the likeness is uncanny.
Yeah.
And you sort of almost get that Transformer vibe as well. Do you remember the piranha fish? There's sort of some kind of element to it in the Transformers 80s movie as well. They're more piranhas, but they did have the heads.
Hmm. Interesting.
When they're chasing, they're getting chased. They were going to water and they're getting chased. Do you remember that?
Mm. Yeah.
Oh, mate, I just, this, it's nuts. I mean, there's that. There's a second. Is there a second rape? Was there like in the day where there's two people? I thought Peggy was going to be approaching these people in a tent. You know the one where she gets the little random ventriloquist doll.
That was weird.
Fucking odd.
That was really weird because it was like they're trying to put a comedy element on it. It was just like, what? There's two people in a tent on the beach, and this guy's just got a ventriloquist doll in a bag. And they
focus in on the ventriloquist doll. She's getting, you know, naked. She's completely naked.
Completely naked, yeah.
And then obviously the tent gets ripped open by these fuckers, kill him, you know, nick the doll. And then she runs away.
She's running, yeah.
She gets caught, doesn't she? Yeah, she did get caught.
Oh, yeah, you think she's going to get away, and then suddenly one jumps out and grabs her. Yeah.
Yeah, we don't see her again.
No, I don't think we see that one.
We see Peggy again.
Oh, it's Peggy, isn't it?
Peggy we see later. God, we'll talk about that later. Yeah, there's a lot of weird editing in this movie. I love the after the fight scene, sort of going down the river to get his revenge, I guess. I don't know. I don't know what he's doing on the boat, and then he chuck a Molotov cocktail. But as he's going down that river, there's a random flick to an owl.
Yeah.
You notice that?
I don't know whether it's... I don't know.
And it's just like stock footage.
Yeah.
It was great.
They've obviously got it out of some wildlife program. Well, yeah, stick that in.
There was also... You know, the son, his... Was it, no, his brother, the one who got like proper attacked, and that's like...
Jim's brother. Yeah.
He was obviously involved in the fight, but he was at the aid of the of Johnny Eagle.
Yeah.
He did. I mean, there must have been some editing, serious editing in that fight, because he seemed to come out worse than any of them. He had like two black eyes and stuff like that. I don't know.
Johnny was pretty messed.
Johnny was.
The makeup on him was quite good because they kept it the continuity throughout the film. Yeah,
agreed.
Because I thought he was going to turn around and have nothing on him, but he had a big old bruise on his cheek throughout the movie.
Oh, his eye was all fucked up and stuff like that. But then he had to deal with that whole, you know, that whole attack at the. Oh my god.
Yeah. So after they get, the Molotov cocktail gets chucked at their house, doesn't it? That Jim's brother gets put in hospital, like you said.
Yeah.
Obviously, he's still alive. Because they say, oh, he's pulled through, but he'll be okay. And he got proper, like, mauled. His face, like, half, like, scraped off, wasn't it?
Yeah, so. And he was dragged under for a while. He was trying to fight him off and stuff out of the gun, and he wasn't getting anywhere, and then... Johnny come to his rescue and drove back, and they all blamed him. He was like, I'm bringing back matey boy. Jumping on him.
That conversation was hilarious because straight away, there's no questions. They just believe him straight up. Oh, yeah, it must have been. He said it was a creature. It must have been. And literally, he's like, I'm going to kill this bastard.
And the creature was like, I'm the creature through a cocktail, Molotov cocktail at the police. Yeah. It's like trying to get out of it and stuff like that. That was funny, man. And the cop's like a dopey cop, isn't he?
He don't know what he's doing, does he? He got a clue. It's just so weird.
Yeah.
And then there's a scientist as well that's just thrown in halfway through the movie where they're just like, oh yeah, she's here to explain the science bit.
Well, she's the Richard Dreyfuss character, right?
So yeah, this is like, yeah, exactly.
This is like, if this is a take on Jaws.
Yeah.
Hmm.
So here's the science bit. Yeah, we've been feeding this salmon up the river to get it nice and fat and juicy. And but all along, you know, she knew about it. And it's just like, yeah. We totally brushed past the little kid getting like literally eaten.
What?
Off the boat.
Oh fuck yeah! Dark, and the whole boat exploding.
Yeah, that's pretty full on.
That's fucking darkness. I mean,
not only does this kid get eaten by a fucking creature from the deep, the boat blows up as well. But a good storyline because they can't really tell what has happened. They don't know that he's been eaten, so it's a good way to kind of cover it up.
The attack at the end.
Mm.
Miss Salmon.
The village.
Miss Salmon. Let's talk about... I mean, oh my God. They literally...
A salmon festival, isn't it?
Yeah. There's a salmon festival and there's got a Miss Salmon. And there's the classic sort of dump the body on the... Sorry, because we missed a bit where they find Peggy pregnant.
Oh, they don't know she's pregnant. They just find her buried in this seaweed naked. That was a good bit, that. Like, there's full-on, like, creatures coming out of every fucking crevice, popping up, attacking them, and they're just fucking firing them down. But yeah, she's alive, isn't she?
Yeah, they bring her back to shore, and then they also bring back a creature, dump it on the show, and they said, we don't know how many there are. Then they all start fucking popping up from under the woodwork.
Yeah.
And they are...
Everywhere.
Just grabbing women, raping them, in front of anyone, attacking the children, attacking the blokes. It's just
carnage at the carnival, I wrote that.
Carnage at the carnival. It's just crazy. And there's moments of like pure insanity. Of like where like, I think Miss Sammons was a DJ and she gets attacked and then she gets her top pulled off and she's running around with her boobs out.
It's literally like a carry on sketch. Yeah.
And then, but then she then picks up a rock and smashes out the, you know, no one else has been able to kick, you know, kill him like this.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then there's like a gang of people turn up with like sticks and start smashing them.
But did you not think, where are they running to? Nobody's running away. They're all just running around in circles.
Where are the guns?
Yeah.
For America, if this is America or Canada, there'd be lots of guns.
Right. Where are the cops? It's like, yeah, one cop that doesn't show up. It's like, where are their armed, like, policemen? Nobody, there's not one, there's like one sheriff and then you don't see no one else.
I know.
It's all locals with hunting rifles.
it's batshit. And then there's like a poor girl that almost gets pulled down, and
yeah,
this is a sort of like the comeuppance bit where the bad guy is sort of like, I don't know,
saves her and saves then gets stuck, and then Johnny has to come around and save him. Yeah, there's a lot of little kind of things in there that,
and then not only that, but there's the drama at the home as well. Oh my god, MVP, right?
This is the thing. This is what I liked about this bit. Is that you've got this crazy scene. You're going, this is batshit. I can't even, what's going on? I'm looking at everything here. But then at the same time, it's a bit like Quiet Place 2, where then you go to the home and it's quiet and it's just like, it's almost like a slasher kind of movie. And then you see the creature with his gangly arms at the window, and then the kid starts crying and he's gone. And you're like, the suspense of that teams with the fucking crazy shit that's going on in the town. It's so really clever. And like, obviously no one's going to get her kids. She's like, this is about the mother protecting her baby. And she ain't going to take no shit.
Really powerful stuff. And really like how she fucking defends herself and defends her home. Really, really powerful stuff. And then after all that chaos and like humor, B-movie, but also just disturbingness all the way through.
Yeah.
You get this, such a classic. It's such a brilliant ending.
It's freaking Alien, isn't it?
Alien, like V stole this. It's just, you know, we get Peggy pregnant and we see what's in her belly. And that's how we end it. And I fucking love that ending. I think that's great.
Yeah, it's a great ending.
Great way to end it.
Because it's like, it's quite depressing in the end, because they're like, the one sheriff that's like, he's literally gone mental, isn't he? He's lost it. Don't know what he's saying or doing. And like, they've managed to kind of scare off or kill off all these kind of things. And literally it's just carnage everywhere. Half the people are dead and or dying. And it's just mad. And then, yeah, to end on that kind of like scene, it's just like, oh my God.
Fucking loved it. Awesome.
Loved it.
Ridiculous movie. Awesome.
Yeah.
Just, I can't believe this exists. I think it's genius.
And it slipped under my radar. Because again, I never saw this in the video shop. Never. I don't know whether it's banned. Maybe it's banned.
I don't know. It could have been. Some of those scenes are fucked up.
We're banning it for fish rape.
Fish rape. Have you got any Matt's facts to share with us?
I have got some Matt's facts.
Listening to this.
So, this is going to answer some of your questions, I hope. They're very, very interesting things. And I want to get your opinions on these because, yeah, it's an interesting thing. I'm gonna read a thing that I dug up online, and I want to get your views on it because this does answer a few questions. And I was like, and I read it. So, as the film was being finished up, producer Roger Corman felt that the picture needed more sex, nudity, and monster shots throughout. So he ordered scenes shot that showed the humanoids attacking, ripping off clothes off their nubile young women. Director Barbara Peters, so this is directed by a woman, who was a feminist who hated rape and violence against women, refused to shoot the scenes. Corman said he'd hire a second director and get her feedback before using any new footage. She agreed to that, but Corman ended up never showing her the new footage and never showed her. So her or the cast or her crew didn't see it either. They didn't see the film until the preview of the film. Peters was furious, protesting that they were inserted purely to show gratuitous nudity. Corman also edited out many of the scenes dealing with the plot and character development in order to make room for the nudity and more creature scenes. Peters complained that this was no longer in the film. She wanted her name taken off. Corman said he'd be happy to do that if only she paid the expenses of redoing the credits. She wouldn't, so her name stayed on the project. Many years later, Peters ended up watching the film on cable and admitted actually ending up being and liking it and saying it was a fun little movie.
Fucking hell. What a bunch of drama, man.
Yeah, absolutely. But I don't know whether this is true or not. It could be just, you know.
Yeah.
But more than likely, when you were talking about some of the editing earlier, it does make me think, well, there are like the ventriloquist thing, random,
Yeah, it's like Spookies, mate. You know, that sort of like random disproportionate thing to the rest of the story.
People getting involved when they shouldn't. It would be interesting to see a film, because you do think some of the characters do lose a bit of their kind of backstories and stuff. So it made sense when I read that. Doesn't make me want to hate the movie or anything, though. This is a very interesting fact. There was only about 3 humanoids from the deep characters made.
Which they fucking got around then, didn't they?
Mate, that is what you call fucking superb editing. So there's only one that was fully working and fully worked. The other two were a bit crap. So the amount of like camera angles and... Because literally in the town, it feels like there's about 30 of these things. But there's only 3 of them made. Which is insane.
That is nuts.
The original title of this movie was actually called Beneath the Darkness, which is quite a good name. But
I prefer Humanoids.
Yeah, because I get it.
It gives it that 50s sort of B-movie feel.
James Horner did the score for this, which is fantastic. He did it in 14 music. Days.
Music is stunning. Music is stunning.
Excellent. And there is a sequel. There was a sequel going to be made that never got made. Called Humanoids from the Deep 2. And apparently the humanoids had progressed, that they could talk. And that was set to come out in 1991, never did. However, a fucking terrible TV remake was done. And it is terrible, because I watched the first 30 minutes and I had to turn it off.
Is it as rapey?
No, it's a lot dumbed down.
A lot of toned down, is it? I'm not watching that shit. I saw that on the fucking IMDb.
It's terrible, mate. But you can watch it for free on YouTube. And last fact is Joe Dante turned down this role. Turned down this movie.
Oh, that's a shame. You missed out.
Well, I think it could have been a different movie if he did it. Maybe it wouldn't have had so much fish rape.
Right. And on that fish rape note, I think you better rate this bad boy.
I'm rating this. Oh my God. I really enjoyed it, man. Just because of the creature bits. I mean, reading that information after did kind of make me think, oh yeah, it does seem like that. You know, I'd love to see possibly another cut of this movie. It'd be cool. But, however, saying that, I love the storyline. Most of the acting was good. There's a couple of ropey actors in there, but who cares? Storyline was great. Creatures were brilliant. I'm going to give this... I want to give it a 9 out of 10, perhaps. Possibly 8. Yeah, 9.
Good, because I'm giving it a fucking 9. This is right up my wheelhouse. Proper B-movie. Dodgy fucking nudity for no reason. Oh, my God. Really weird editing choices. It's just... It's synonymous for a reason. More people need to get out and watch this hunk of joy.
It should be seen.
Should be seen, because it's just like, from movie making, like special effects and the way you put together a script, fantastic. And then you can also, on the back cut side of it, you're like, well, actually, there's some choices that, as a director, maybe you should think twice about. It's a real little lesson learned, I think, from movie making. It's really interesting.
Creature, if you like creatures and you like fucking this, that sort of shit, it's quality. It's just a really good little film. I'm so glad we watched it.
Humanoids from the Deep.
Yes.
Loved it. Right.
Interesting, because it's your pick for the next one. So I'm very... By the look on your face, you haven't even decided, which is not a good thing. You fucking prick.
The one that you've been bugging me for a long, long time, so that we can move on the franchise and get to some really interesting movies. And I'm going to pick Nightmare on Elm Street Part 2.
Yeah! You're going to love this.
Yeah.
Men. Men, 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 men.
Is that going to be the title? So, yeah, I'm sure John will be pleased as well.
Mate, I just want to see some towel whipping.
Maybe get John on.
Yeah,
he loves a bit of Nightmare on Elm Street Part 2.
He's a big fan.
We'll eventually get to Wes Craven's New Nightmare for you.
I just want to get to 3.
All right, so next episode. So that was episode 82 done. Next episode, we're going to be going hopefully to the cinema. There's a couple at the cinema that we might be checking out. Lovely, lovely bits of movies. You know, we've got A Forever Purge and we've got New Escape Room. Something to scream about. Get in touch. get involved. Send us your ideas for a movie that you'd like to watch, a horror movie, obviously, that you'd like to watch from the antagonist's point of view. Flip the movie on its head. Let's hear them. The best one will get a badge sent out. There you go. That's a bit of an incentive. The logo, the new logo. And then I just pulled from the vault. Robert Englund, Wes Craven. No, not Wes Craven. Robert, we're not Wes Craven. Back to Wes Craven yet. A Nightmare on Elm Street Part 2. Bring it on. And on that note, there's only one more thing to say.
Well done. You got through the podcast.
When there's no more room in hell, here's another podcast.
I am the devil, and I am here to do the devil's work.
You can follow us on Twitter at @DrawOneLast, Instagram at @DrawOneLastBreath, or pop us an email at @DrawOneLastBreathPod@hotmail.com.